the previous X-ray.
Yes, ma'am. Chest X-ray POVO with a normal cardiothoracic ratio. Yes. Looks like RV type of apex, madam, with MPA okay. dilated.
Okay.
Right. Vascularity looks normal, pulmonary vascularity. Otherwise, no right atrial enlargement. And aortic knuckle is normal, madam. So, right RV type of apex with prominent MPA.
Vascularity, RPA, is it not dilated?
Yes, madam, RPA dilated.
Yeah, RPA, the proximal PAs are dilated. See, the LPA is overlapped by the MPA, so you're not able to see. Actually, you're able to see a shadow behind it, but it's okay if you don't comment on that. But RPA is significantly dilated. But compared to that, how is the peripheral vasculature?
Peripheral pruning is there, madam. Probably Eisenmenger's is one chart.
Yeah, you should have commented about that. Yeah. Yeah, you should have commented about pruning. I expected that. See, there is significantly dilated proximal PA, but suddenly it is pruned off. Okay. So given the clinical history and given this X-ray, it is Eisenmenger syndrome. Okay. So how is this different from the previous X-ray? Previous X-ray also you found very dilated proximal PAs, but peripherally it is not increased vasculature. So how do you differentiate between, of course, based on your clinical judgment, clinical history and picture of the child? Apart from that, some subtle signs like, see, in an Eisenmenger, definitely the MPA is hugely dilated like this. But if you see in a TOF absent pulmonary valve, the branch PAs will be aneurysmally dilated, but the actual trunk of the PA will not be as dilated as you see in the Eisenmenger. Okay? You got the point? Difference between these two? Okay.
Yes.
So, this is Eisenmenger X-ray and that is TOF absent pulmonary valve. So, and in Eisenmenger syndrome, like, due to ASD, VSD, PDA. Is there any difference in the X-rays due to ASD, VSD, PDA? Can you find out that this is Eisenmenger ASD and this is Eisenmenger other VSD or PDA? Yes? Yes or no? If no, you can tell. It's okay.
In PDA, aorta will be prominent, madam. Shunt is extracardiac. In PDA with Eisenmenger, aortic okay. knuckle also will be prominent.
Okay. Good, then?
In VSD, great vessels will be normal, madam. RV type of apex will be there. In ASD, dilated right atrium will be same. Apart from that, great vessels will be normal.
Okay, see, that is in any other ASD, VSD, PDA. No, you told the difference, what we discussed last class. But in a Eisenmenger, once Eisenmenger sets in, in a PDA and VSD, the cardiomegaly starts coming down, no? As the pH becomes severe, the cardiomegaly starts coming down. So, in a full-blown Eisenmenger, in a VSD and a PDA, there is no cardiomegaly. The heart size is normal. But in an ASD, the cardiomegaly still persists. Even though the child or the person has gone in for an Eisenmenger, the adult patient who presents with Eisenmenger in an ASD, the cardiomegaly can still be there on the X-ray. Okay? So, but in a VSD and PDA, if cardiomegaly is still there, then you know that there is still a large shunt. If it is true Eisenmenger, the size of the heart would have come back to normal. So, that was about few cyanotic heart defects we saw. Then a mixed collection of cases I'll show you. So, one of you can take this X-ray. This is an adult who presented with acute onset of respiratory distress, like a few days of onset of respiratory distress. So, one of you can read this. Who wants to take this up? Please come forward fast. People who are answering the chat can unmute yourself and talk, no? You don't want to? Yes, Arush, you want to unmute yourself? We have only 15 minutes left. Please come forward. Or shall I just continue? Okay. So, yes.
This is a chest X-ray PAVO, madam. Anand, madam.
Okay.
Chest X-ray
continue.
PAVO, madam. With grossly dilated heart, cardiothoracic ratio more than 50%. And
more than? More than
50, as it is mentioned, adult madam, it is more than 50%. So cardiomegaly is there.
Okay.
And okay. It is a globular enlargement, madam, with right atrial dilatation is there. Apex, I could not able to comment, madam. Otherwise, narrow vascular pedicle is there. Has a history suggestive of breathlessness and short duration, and it is looking like a leather bottle appearance. So probably pericardial effusion.
Yes. So this is an X-ray of a pericardial effusion. Here you see a cardiomegaly, the CT ratio is increased, and a narrow vascular pedicle. And how is the pulmonary vascularity? You didn't comment about that.
Decreased, madam.
Okay, so the X-ray film quality is not good. So at least it is not. You don't see gross changes in the pulmonary vascularity. Okay, so this is a classical water bottle appearance or leather bottle. The water bottle is not the typical the present day water bottle. So this is the leather type water bottle which was being used in those days. So if you keep that bottle filled with water, so it will take this shape. That's why it's called as the water bottle appearance with a narrow pedicle. How is this different from a dilated cardiomyopathy? I'll show you an X-ray of a dilated. This is a adolescent child with dilated cardiomyopathy, post-viral dilated cardiomyopathy. So how is, see here also you will see cardiomegaly, here also you see cardiomegaly. So what are the subtle signs between the pericardial effusion and the dilated cardiomyopathy? Yes, somebody answers cardiophrenic ankle, then
pulmonary vascularity. Pulmonary venous congestion will be there in the case of dilated cardiomyopathy, but not
so
in
the pulmonary. Yes, so the pulmonary vascularity is definitely abnormal in dilated cardiomyopathy, while you don't see much difference in the vascularity in pericardial effusion. And the vascular pedicle is narrow in pericardial effusion, but vascular pedicle is usually wide in because of the congestion and volume changes. In the vascular pedicle is dilated in dilated cardiomyopathy. And as you told, the cardiophrenic angle, here it is an obtuse cardiophrenic angle, but here if you see, there is an acute cardiophrenic angle in pericardial effusion. So these are the subtle signs differences to know that is pericardial effusion and this is a true cardiomegaly, like, you know, it is due to the heart enlargement. Okay, so we'll move on to the next case. This is again an adolescent with the hypoxia. Yeah, saturation of 88%, but otherwise adolescent is not having any respiratory distress or anything at rest. So this is the X-ray taken. So one of you can read this. I think this is simple. You will get this
X-ray PA view, madam, with cardiothoracic ratio normal. Pulmonary vascularity appears like normal, but there is a opacification in the lower lobe.
So,
probably aneurysm, madam, or AV malformation.
Okay.
As patient is cyanotic, we can consider for pulmonary AV malformation.
Yes, if I had not given the history, if you say it could be an LV aneurysm, okay, even then I wouldn't agree because there is no actual continuity from the heart. But even I would have still agreed. But now, given this data that the saturation is 88%, you have to consider this as a possible pulmonary AV malformation. So the next clue I wanted to give, if you didn't pick up, is that contrast echo showed contrast in the left atrium after 3 to 4 cardiac cycles in the absence of any intra-atrial shunt. Okay, so this is a pulmonary AVM. Okay, so who wants to take this? This is a child with moderate sized atrial septal defect and moderate pulmonary arterial hypertension. So echo showed moderate sized ASD, but this is the X-ray.
And this is a chest X-ray PA view with normal exposure. There is no rotation. Situs is solitus. Then there is mesocardia, ma'am. It is, or mesocardia, more of dextrocardia because the apex is on the right hand side. Apart from that, if we see, ma'am, there is on the right hand side there is this opacity in the lung field that we can see, ma'am. It's like the Turkish sword appearance, which is characteristic of scimitar syndrome.
Okay,
because there is dextro version along with the scimitar syndrome.
Yes, yes. So at the first instance, you may think that this is dextrocardia, but when you see this, you know that this is the scimitar sign or the Turkish sword sign. So this is suggestive of classical scimitar syndrome. So this is dextro version and not true dextrocardia. So there is the right lung volume will be smaller and hence the heart will be pulled towards the right. Somebody had answered in the chat as a scimitar sign, which is correct. But infracardiac TAPVC, it is not TAPVC. No, it's an infracardiac PAPVC. Partial anomalous pulmonary venous drainage. Only the right-sided veins will be draining into the IVC. So what is the cause of PAH in scimitar? I told PAH was there. So what are all the reasons that a child can have pulmonary artery hypertension in scimitar syndrome? Can you enumerate 3 or 4?
Ma'am, presence of collaterals, which are supplying the collaterals from the aorta, which are supplying the lung. Then apart from that, because of the hypoplasia of the right lung, ma'am. So there, because of that, there is because of that, there is pulmonary hypertension, and
very good.
And third one.
See, this itself is a shunt, no? This is a PAPVC, no? There is a shunt, and also there can be additional shunts in many of them. As I told you, this child had ASD means, so that is an additional shunt. ASD plus PAPVC. So presence of shunt. Presence of lung hypoplasia, then most of them have a additional collateral from the abdominal part of the aorta, descending aorta to the right lung. So that is one reason. And some of them can have an obstruction where the pulmonary vein is joining the IVC. So pulmonary venous obstruction. So these are all causes which can contribute to pulmonary arterial hypertension in scimitar. Okay. So this one, who wants to take this? I'm sorry for the poor quality of the X-ray. It is very hazy. You can see and comment. This is an adult with respiratory distress and abdominal distension and pedal edema.
Case of sorry madam, this is a chest X-ray PA view madam.
Yes.
With a normal cardiothoracic ratio and normal vascularity with the pericardial calcification seen in the lower border. Arc type calcification, madam. So, correlating with the symptoms, probably patient is having constrictive pericarditis.
Very good, very good. So, I wanted to show you the pericardial calcification. Usually, in a constrictive pericarditis, there is straightening of the right heart border. There can be calcifications, and SVC is usually dilated, but in this X-ray, we don't see that very clearly. But they can have SVC dilatation. So, this is CP. Okay, good. So, this is an 8-year-old child, post-operated. You can see the sternal bias. It is post-operative child. So, can you read this X-ray? I'll give you more clues if you can't find out.
Ma'am, this is a post-operative chest X-ray, AP view. PA view. Situs solitus, ma'am, levocardia. CT ratio is around 0.6. Then we can see the sternal wires. Apart from that, ma'am, if we see there is no right atrial enlargement. Then here, ma'am, there is prominence of the pulmonary artery. It appears dilated. Apart from that, there is a lesion here, ma'am, a calcified structure which can be seen. And most likely, ma'am, it's the aortic valve. This structure
is it looking like a valve? Maybe I should have put the lateral view also. That would have given a clue to you. This is not aortic valve. Can you see that there is some prominence here? This part, part corresponds to the RVOT and pulmonary artery.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So this is actually a RVPA conduit.
RVOT stent.
No, it is not a stent. This is an RV to PA conduit. The conduit has calcified. A homograft was used as a conduit from RV to PA. and in the infancy, and now the child is 8 years and this has calcified. So I just wanted to show the, you know, in a congenital, in a child, the cause of calcification is more commonly this RV to PA conduit, you will see. What are the other reasons or other causes of calcification you can see on the heart?
Ma'am, there can be like in older adults, it can be the aortic valve calcification. Then if there is a PDA, which is, we can see calcification of patent of PDA, which can be seen. Then in constrictive pericarditis, we can see calcification of the pericardium. Then, then RV to PA conduit, if we have put, we can see calcification, calcified monocuspid valve. If we do a mono, if we put a monocuspid or a bicuspid pulmonary valve, we can see calcification also. And,
Someone has answered LA myxoma, that is also correct. Any thrombus can also calcify in the long run. Then any aneurysms like LV aneurysm post-infarct and all, in the when they are chronic, they can calcify. So these are some of the causes of calcification. So these are the areas you can see on the X-ray. So this is where you can see the pericardial calcification. This is where the myxoma in the RA. If it is LA, a little more this side you will see. Coronary calcifications you can see. All this mostly in the elderly, not in the children. So coronary calcifications you can see. Aortic calcifications you can see. And this is post-infarct LV aneurysm calcifications and valvar calcifications. In old age, you would have seen many mitral annular calcifications and aortic valve calcifications. So these are all the causes of calcifications you can see on the X-ray. Okay, this is a simple one. This is a adult with ejection click and systolic murmur. So that I think that gives away the diagnosis to you, but you can read it. One of you can read.
Chest X-ray PAV, madam, with normal cardiothoracic ratio and normal pulmonary vasculature. Chambers are not dilated. Aorta, ascending aorta dilated, madam. With given history, ejection click and dilated ascending aorta, probably bicuspid aortic wall with aortic stenosis and post-aortic dilatation.
Very good. Okay. So the finding in this X-ray is that and with the history, it is aortic stenosis. Good. So this is this child had a loud second heart sound and was diagnosed to have congenital heart disease since early childhood, but is just on follow-up, not treated. So there's a loud second heart sound. So what do you think this could be? Yes, someone has answered. This is CTGA. So you don't see the ascending aorta at this side. You don't see the ascending aortic shadow at all this side. So here you see that this is a prominent structure you see here. This is because of the L malposed aorta. This is very classical of a corrected transposition in a situs solitus. Okay, so this is a CTGA X-ray. Or you can't say CTGA. Actually, somebody has answered it's an L malposed aorta. Actually, truly speaking, you can only say that it is L malposed aorta. It can just be a DILV also with an L malposed aorta. So you can't truly say this is, you don't know what is the AV concordance, BA, AV relationship, BA relationship. If there is a L malposed aorta, that much you can tell. Most probably it is CTG. So this is just a smarter one word answer somebody wants to give. You can type it in the chat box also.
Ma'am, there is a breakage of the pacemaker lead.
Yes, there's a fracture of the pacemaker lead. Good. This one?
There is thick. Ma'am, it has been displaced. Yes. The pacemaker has gone into the abdominal cavity from the thoracic cavity.
Yes. So there is displacement of the leads. No, this is the atrial lead. It should have been here, and this is the ventricular lead, which should be here. It is displacement of the leads. Very good. Okay. What valve is this? What type of valve?
Ball and cage.
Ball and cage valve. Very good. So what valve is this? In the mitral position or aortic?
Mitral position.
How do you say the valve? Of course, in a Star Edward, you know that based on the the flow direction
number of
the flow, you will tell. But stress, otherwise, how do you say it is mitral or aortic?
Mit- lateral, it will have four struts will be there, ma'am. And in aortic, there will be three struts and there will be direction of the flow.
Okay, then based on the position on the X-ray?
From hilum to right line, ma'am, from hilum to...
Yes, from hilum to right cardiofrenic angle, you draw a line. Yeah, this is the right cardiofrenic angle. From there to the left hilum, if you draw a line, usually the mitral will fall below that line and the aortic will fall above the line. Okay, similarly in the lateral X-ray, if you draw the line from the apex to the carina, the mitral will be below the line and aortic will be above the line. So based on that, you'll be able to say whether this is mitral or in aortic position. So, okay. X-rays, I think that is all. We have exhausted the time also. So, I will leave you with this one quiz. Angio quiz, this is actually. So, this was a kid who was diagnosed to have tricuspid atresia, who presented with cyanotic spells and surgery was done in his country. The first surgery was not done here. It was done in his country. This child was from another country. So they have done a BT shunt, that's what the papers say. So they have come to us now for the next stage surgery and this is the angiogram. So can one of you read the angiogram? It is an interesting one, so I thought I'll just put it as a quiz to you.
Ma'am, this is a angiogram, which is a pigtail angiogram in AP view. Okay. The course of the catheter is from the femoral artery to the ascending aorta, to the arch of aorta, into the right subclavian artery, and it shows opacification of the right subclavian artery. There is the right vertical ma'am, I think it's the followed by the right carotid also, ma'am, and there is. Mm-hmm. This is the vertebral artery, sorry, but that appears to be dilated, ma'am.
Shall I freeze it? Okay, I'll freeze it for you. Basically, there is dilated right subclavian artery. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
I told you BT shunt.
There is a BT shunt, ma'am.
Okay, so what is this? Okay.
This is a BT shunt and apart from that, there are multiple collaterals which can be seen, ma'am. Multiple collaterals which are arising from...
Like, where is the BT shunt joining? I can't give you...
Sir, it's giving you a clue. That is the shunt, but joining. Where is it? Where is it, yeah?
Is it joining into the pulmonary vein, ma'am?
Yeah. So, in a BT shunt, if I give an injection in the subclavian, what should fill after the shunt opacification?
The artery should fill, ma'am.
The right pulmonary artery should have filled, no?
But here
the right pulmonary artery should fill. Yeah, then you should see the peripheral vasculature, the lung lobes. And then in the levo phase, you should see the veins. But here, you directly after the shunt opacification, you are seeing the veins filling and the left atrium is
filling.
Okay. So, this is an inadvertent placement of, placement of the BT shunt onto the pulmonary vein. Okay, so since this was an interesting one, I thought I'll show it in the last. Okay, with that, we'll end the session.
Thank you very much, Dr. Sai Leela. It's a really very great collections and a good interaction with all students. Maybe we may request you to come back again some stage in the fourth week. Thank you very much. If there are any questions, please interact with Dr. Sai Leela through WhatsApp group. Thank you very much. I'll end this session then.
Thank you, sir.